Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today's video I'm going to be doing a Q&A answering everyone's questions about studying maths at uni.
There are always so many people in the comments asking questions because apparently there aren't that many people on YouTube who talk about maths, which is fair enough.
So I've got a mixture of like frequently asked questions. I asked for some questions on Twitter and Instagram, so I'm going to answer those today. Just a little disclaimer before I start, obviously I'm filming outside right now. There are a lot of birds cheeping, let's just treat it as like atmospheric noise. I should probably say for context, if you are new around here, that I am a maths graduate. I went to Southampton first and I graduated a year ago now. I had a gap year, so I can't really answer that much about employment. Let's start with the big one. How difficult is a maths degree? I'd say it was definitely up there in the list of the most difficult degrees. I mean, maybe I'm biased because I want to think I'm smart, but it is really difficult and you do have to apply yourself a lot. And I'm not saying that people who do other courses and study other things don't have to work hard, because I mean, whatever you end up doing, if you're doing a degree, you're going to be working hard. I think a lot of other courses, especially more of like the social sciences, any kind of essay writing subjects, the work is less about understanding what's going on and more about just sitting down and putting hours in to write your essays or learn the facts or whatever it is that you've got to do to pass your course. Whereas for maths, it takes time and it takes effort to just be able to understand it. And then on top of that, you've got to go and put in your hours of work to complete whatever task you've been given to do. So to answer your question, I would say pretty difficult, but it's not unmanageable. I mean, I wouldn't consider myself like a genius, but I got a first. So if you put the work in and you're willing to make the effort to learn things, then you'll be absolutely fine. But it's definitely more of a challenging degree than most, I would say. But like I said, maybe I'm biased. Following on from that, another big question that I'm always asked, and I think that's fair enough because I do talk about it a lot, is how much of a step up is it from A-level to degree maths? If you've watched any of my maths videos before, you'll have heard me say that the jump is just ridiculous. The majority of university maths is theory-based. Every so often you get a module where they have some computational questions and you have to work something out. But even then, most of those exam papers are still theory-based, and it's going to be things like asking you to state definitions, theorems, prove things. And there's a lot of reasoning. You've always got to know why something happens. You can't just state it until it's like 100% proven. We aren't using it at all. So we start right at the beginning with the axioms of real numbers, which are like the most basic rules of maths, the things that we've always taken for granted. Things like timesing by zero makes zero, adding zero makes the same thing, timesing by one makes the same thing. And then you use those as your basic building blocks to literally prove everything else that you learned. Very different to the sort of teaching style that there is at A level. You all know that A level syllabus, and the lecturers know that that's your knowledge, so that's where they're going to start from. As I said before, everything you're doing from first principles. If they bring up something from A level, they're going to introduce it the same way that they introduce any other theorem, and you're going to prove it. So everything's going to be recapped. There shouldn't be any real worry about how difficult the step up will be. As I said, the step up isn't necessarily in like the maths that you're doing, it's just the way that you're approaching it, and that's something that you will just get used to over time. The next question is like the big question that people always ask me, and it's how important is further maths for studying maths at uni? I'd say on my course 70% did do further maths and 30% didn't, and it became pretty level straight away really, because it wasn't like we were jumping in straight from where we'd finished off further maths. It was, like I said, starting from the very beginning and working our way up. So the real advantage that further maths gives you is being a bit more familiar with some of the topics like complex numbers, differential equations, and vectors, which are all things which are quite key elements of first year. I know some schools don't offer further maths, but if you've got the option to do it, it shows dedication to the subject, which is good for applications. You're going to be going into your course with more experience, more confidence, more understanding of slightly more complex topics. And at the end of the day, if you're considering studying maths at uni, it's likely that you're already pretty good at it and it comes pretty naturally to you, in which case it's going to be an easy A level, so just do it. I feel like because it's just kind of an extension of maths, the work you put in is maybe like 3/4 of what you'd put into like a single subject A level, if that makes sense. What do I think of maths and philosophy degree, or maths with anything else? Yeah, I think that's a great idea. Maths and philosophy go really well together because they're both very theoretical. I don't know if you know this, but I started my degree doing maths with Spanish, and I did that for one semester before I changed out. Personal circumstances, I couldn't carry on with it, but especially at the beginning when everything is so intense and it's just a lot of maths and you're not quite used to it, it was nice, I found, to go and do something that wasn't maths for a while. So if there's something that you're passionate about and want to carry on doing it, then definitely do. Pure or applied maths? For me, pure all the way. I'm not an applied maths girl. I don't like it. There's two questions about like employment chances. One of them is from Charlotte. It says, what kind of work experience and internships did you do? Advice to improve employability. And I didn't do any maths related work experience. I didn't take out a year to go into industry or anything. I think all of those things are a really good idea, but at the time I was just focusing on my studies. In terms of advice to improve employability, I think you've just hit the nail on the head there. Like, just go out and get experience. I'm definitely not the best person to ask about this. In fact, I'm the one who needs the advice for this, so let me know if you have any. The other question on employment is, how good of an idea is it in terms of employment after you get your degree? I think that's saying, like, how good are the employment prospects for maths graduates? And they're pretty good. Maths is a highly sought after field. Anything in STEM is, but especially with maths, it's a certain way of thinking which employers are really looking for. So I think in terms of prospects for jobs for graduates, they're very good. It's just, if you don't apply for any, then you don't get any. Hi. Oh, and there's another one actually. What career paths are there for maths graduates? I hate anything to do with finance. I, again, am not the best person to ask because I don't have any experience in terms of maths employment. I think the main ones are finance, like you said, actuarial things, which can be linked to finance. And then the other two main branches, I suppose, are like computing things and teaching. But of course you don't have to go into any of those like four things which just came off the top of my head. Like, doesn't even have to be a maths related job, but so many jobs are after people with the skills that a maths degree brings. I think honestly your options are pretty much limitless.
The limit does not exist.
Did you feel less smart than your peers in seminars? Yes, all the time. And kind of related to this as well actually is, how good do you need to be to do really well? People who talk in seminars are usually the ones who are pretty confident. It's easy to feel like you're the only one, because when you're just looking at the people who are talking, it feels like you're the only one who isn't. But if you look around you, there are a lot of other people who are feeling the exact same way as you. And to be honest, a lot of the people who are talking and asking questions are probably just putting on a front, and underneath they're still a bit confused too. If you get accepted to do maths at uni, then you're good enough to do it, and that's that. There are obviously some people who really stand out to be like super intelligent, and you're just kind of in awe of how they understand everything so fast, but you don't have to be that kind of person to do well, not at all. At the end of the day, it all just comes down to how hard you work, putting the hours in, just making the effort. That if you don't understand something you ask, I don't know if you ever met a maths lecturer, but if you show the slightest bit of interest in their like specialist subject, they will be so happy to talk to you about it. I think you just need to be smart about how you answer exams, really hone in on that exam technique. Look out for any hints in lectures about what the lecturer is going to be looking for in an exam situation. Study any kind of example answers that they've written up for you or gone through in a lecture, and you take out the elements that they're looking for and you just reproduce them. Get used to doing the questions that way around. The other thing is being smart about the modules you take. I know personally I perform a lot better in exams than I do with coursework, so I would always try to choose modules which were mostly exam. I liked having sort of 80% exam, 20% coursework. That was like my ideal level. Ask around as well, people in the year above you, what modules do they find interesting, what lecturers do they like, and are there any modules which seem to follow the same kind of formula every year? Because those ones, they're your safe bets, they're the ones that you can count on, that if all else fails you can fall back to past exam papers, because the past exam material is the most relevant. So if you feel like you're not like smart enough to do a maths degree, that's not true first of all, but second of all, there are ways to kind of outsmart the smart ones and just do well anyway. How many hours did you have to put in a week to keep up with the work? I'm just trying to think. So I would have about 15 to 20 hours of contact time a week. Some of that was like tutorials or workshops, so they weren't compulsory things. There wasn't anything new that I was learning. It was kind of more of a time to ask any questions that I had. In terms of actual lectures, I had 3 a week for each module, and I did 4 modules. So that's 12 hours a week of lectures that I had. Quite often there's not enough time in the lecture to process the information. All you can do is write it down. So I'd say like 1 hour of lectures to 1 hour at home writing up my notes if I'd missed anything in the lecture, and then understanding what it was about. Then I'd usually spend more time studying whenever I had an assignment. So for most modules it was like once a week there was a little problem sheet. When I say little, there was probably like 5 questions, and it took between like 4-6 hours maybe. I think it really does vary depending on what kind of modules you're doing, the time of year, and what coursework you've got due, and all sorts of factors. But for the most part, that 1 hour after each lecture I think is key, and then maybe 4 hours a week on top of that for each module. But obviously everyone's going to be different and work at different speeds and want to spend different amounts of time on different things. So this question is, how do I study? So how do I remember how to do things? How do I keep things in my brain? For me, it was writing things down and doing practice questions. I always tell my students this as well, like the way you learn is by doing practice questions. So any kind of computational thing that we would need to know for the exam, I would just do a load of questions. After doing a couple of questions, I would maybe write down on a piece of paper or on one of those little like revision card things, like bullet point notes of how to do that particular method of that computation. And in terms of the theory stuff, writing it down is just, that's how I learn things. So you might have to know a definition more or less word for word. And the way I would learn that is literally writing it down on a piece of paper and then kind of like you would do lines at school, like just keep repeating it, writing it down and down, and each time comparing it to like the original, underlining anything that wasn't right. Saying out loud really helps as well for me. I like when I can hear things, they stay in my head longer. But I think because you're going to be writing it in the exam, it's important to know how to write it down as well. So that's more or less how I would study. I would write everything on a revision card and then just practice writing things out again. Practice questions, exam questions, past papers, whatever you can get your hands on, do them all. Especially anything that has been written by the lecturer who is examining you, because you'll get used to their style, you'll get used to the kind of things they're expecting of you, what they're going to ask, and also what they're going to look for in the answers. Did you have as much free time as your friends from other courses? No. In first year, I lived with a group of people who didn't study maths, and they had a lot more free time than me. They had less contact hours, and also they had less work to be doing outside of lectures. In my case, I became closer with my maths friends, so all of my closest friends were also doing maths and had the same amount of free time as me. So it worked out quite well in that aspect, because we were all on the same page in terms of like how much work we had to do and how much time we had to spend with each other outside of uni. And we did still spend time together. Like, it's not all studying. I know I say like it's a lot of work and there's a lot of hours, and that's true, but there is still time for other things on your life. So don't worry, don't feel like your life's going to be consumed by uni stuff. How hard will it be, and will it be easier at some point? As I've already said, it is pretty hard, especially to begin with. You expect it's going to be hard, like I'm telling you right now it's going to be hard, and you're like, yeah, of course it's going to be hard. But when you get there, like, you're just not going to be prepared. But that's okay, and it gets easier. It really does. Like, your brain adapts, you adjust, you get used to the teaching style and the learning style and what's expected of you. So even though the first few weeks may seem impossible, at least they did for me, you'll get through it and it will get easier. Things to include in personal statement for maths. That's been a while since I did that. I think you should Google that one, because it has been a while since I wrote my personal statement. It's been what, like 5 years or so? Ooh, that's horrible to think about. All they really want to see is that you're dedicated enough to your chosen field of study, so maths in this case, that you're going to put in 3 years of work for it at uni, go through all the like emotional labour and the turmoil of having to study maths, and then come out at the end and still want to study it. Anything you've done which shows that outside of school, you're still interested in maths, you're still dedicating your time to it. Another good idea is to think back to like when you first knew you liked the subject, or knew that you wanted to study it, or something that happened at a young age that really influenced you into enjoying that subject. For me, my dad taught me when I was about 4 or 5 that there were 3,600 seconds in an hour, because there were 60 seconds in a minute and 60 minutes in an hour. So that more or less taught me how multiplication worked, and then ever since then I could just do it, which is pretty impressive for a 5-year-old. So if you can think of any stories or anecdotes like that, if I can find something, I'll put a link below about personal statements for maths, because like I said, it's been a while since I wrote mine. What do you do if you don't understand a maths question? It's always good to have a go yourself first, because you may be able to work out yourself, but if not, then at least you have explored all the avenues you can think of and you know what exactly it is that you don't understand, so you can actually ask someone. I always get a piece of paper and I jot things down. I write down any symbols used, write the definition of any words, and just try and piece things together, try and work out what they're actually asking. The next step, if that doesn't really get you anywhere, is to talk to someone else on your course. Either they're stuck as well, which means you can work together to solve it, or they already worked out the answer, in which case they can help you. And hopefully, as well as them just telling you the answer, they'll be able to explain to you how they got there, so you can see their perspective and their approach, so next time you can actually do it on your own. If you're still stuck, then talk to a member of staff, a lecturer, a postgraduate. It depends on your uni, but for mine, we could speak to them after a lecture, speak to them in a tutorial. You could go to a student workshop where any lecturer will be more than happy to help you work it out. Even if it's not their personal like field of study, maths lecturers are massive nerds and they'll just more than happily sit down and work through a maths problem with you. You can email your lecturer. Sometimes they have like a forum you can post on, or they give you a telephone extension to call. I've even had a couple of lecturers who have had hashtags So you can just hashtag on Twitter your question and they will bring it up anonymously in the lecture, which I think is awesome. There are so many ways to ask for help, but the most important thing is that you do ask them for help, because it's their job to help you. It's their job to make sure that you know everything you need to know and that you pass your exam. So they'll be more than happy to help you, and they probably rejoice in the fact that someone's taking interest in their course. What are exams like for Uni Maths? I feel like that's going to be different for everybody, and like every university, every course, and then every module as well. For most modules, it's mostly exam based. There's a little bit of coursework, which is either like a worksheet or a little in-class test. Most of your marks will come from the exam. I had a couple of exams with multiple choice sections, but mostly it's all just written like normal. And to be honest, I mostly follow the pattern of your notes. If in lectures you've done a lot of computations, then that's going to be a good indicator that that's kind of the style of exam as well. I think I'll have to show you a paper to kind of give you an idea of what an exam would look like, but I think her name is Tibby's on YouTube. She's done some videos about looking through university maths papers, and she kind of goes through them, shows you the kind of questions, and then she actually answers a couple as well. So if you're wondering and you're curious, I would say go and check out her channel for all sorts of maths related content. I think she's actually a physicist, I might be wrong. And we'll finish with something lighthearted. What was my favourite part of the course? My favourite module was graph theory, and just in general, like, my favourite part of studying was probably writing my notes. I really enjoyed writing notes. I love making them look really pretty, and I really miss it. Okay, so that's more or less all the questions that I got. Some of them I don't feel qualified enough to like answer in a video, like career stuff and stuff about masters. Like, I don't have the personal experience to talk about that. One more thing, my friend Andy, who I lived with in first year, has given me an info sheet all about starting uni. It's specifically about Southampton, but I think you can generalize most things to like whatever uni you're going to. So I'm gonna leave a link to that in the description below. Feel free if you want a little bit of information about starting uni. This is Andy's writing, not mine. So if there's any bad advice, I blame him. But no, I've read it through, it's very informative. It's good advice about stuff to take to uni and like how to adjust in the first few weeks. So that will be linked in the description if you want to download it. Thank you all for your questions. I hope I answered them well. Good luck if you're starting uni in the next few weeks. It's gonna be a blast, you're gonna love it. Thank you all very much for watching, and I will see you very soon for another Maths at Uni video. It's coming very soon, I promise.